President Niinistö, ladies and gentlemen, warmly welcome to this first country session where we are pleased to present you, to you Finland as an Arctic expert. I am Hannu Halinen, the Arctic Ambassador of Finland. I will be moderating this session. Among the heads of state in the world, very few can claim to know what the Arctic is all about. President Grimson is one of them, and President Niinistö is another one. We all heard him speaking this morning on the global Arctic and our responsibility to take care of it. Now we are honored to hear him open the Finnish country session. Mr. President, you have the floor.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us in the Finland country session. We will present you with three top-notch presentations that will focus on key features of our Arctic expertise, Arctic research, Arctic economy, and sustainable Arctic technology, or clean tech. Finns are well known for going straight to the point, and I will not disappoint you. Let me now give you some undeniable facts that show why Finland claims to be a real Arctic expert. Our airports are never closed because of snow. There's no chaos on our roads, even on heavy snowstorms. That's because we have snow-how. It's not just show-how. All Finnish ports are ice-covered during winter, practically every winter. I believe we are the only country in the world experiencing this, but our ports are never closed, thanks to our icebreakers. Ice is not a problem to us. It is only a question of ice management. We know how to break the ice. After all, 60% of all icebreakers in the world are built in Finland. And just an hour ago, somebody said to me, not a Finn, that out of the best ones, 100% is built in Finland. So when it comes to new innovations in ice breaking and ice management technologies, you just have to turn to Finland. Furthermore, concepts such as renewable energy, clean tech, and green mining are routinely applied in our Arctic activities. They are business as usual for Finland. Finally, you all surely know where Santa Claus comes from. Yes, of course, from Finland. Unfortunately, we couldn't take him with us because he's got a busy time at the moment, but he's not alone there. In Finnish Lapland, above the Arctic Circle, we have almost 100,000 hotel beds. Finland welcomes about 90% of all Arctic tourists. How did we Finns come up with such a wide and deep-rooted Arctic expertise? Well, we are Arctic citizens, one-third of the overall population living in the whole circumpolar Arctic above the 60 degrees of latitude are Finns. We live and work there, always have. Dear friends, in my opening speech this morning I stressed the necessity of finding a sustainable way of combining economic opportunities and environmental risks in the Arctic. If we don't care about risks, we will destroy our opportunities. So if we care about opportunities, we must care about risks as well. The right combination, what to do, what not to do, and how to do, can be found. Helping ourselves and others to find the right balance and sustainable way of working in the North is the essence of our role as an Arctic expert nation. We do this by providing high-level scientific research to the Arctic community. We offer clean tech solutions which are designed and tested in the Arctic conditions. I have a team of well-established makers of our Arctic know-how here with me. This Team Finland will go deeper in explaining our Arctic expertise. Let's now hear what they will say. Thank you.
Yes, indeed. Let's hear from our Arctic experts. Thank you so much, Mr. President. As the first speaker, I am so happy to introduce to you my friend and partner over the Arctic over the last 5 years in the Arctic business, Mr. Tero Vauraste, the CEO and president of the Finnish icebreaking fleet, Arctia Shipping Company. Tero has contributed to the Finnish Arctic strategy and expertise far beyond the mission of his own company. Frankly, I sometimes wonder where does he find the time to manage his own business, the company. Anyhow, we are very grateful for his input in the Arctic cooperation as a whole. Mr. Vauraste, let's hear it from you.
Your Excellency, Mr. President Grimson, and Your Excellency, Mr. President Niinistö, my friend Hannu, thank you for the kind words. I'm lucky that my chairman of the board is not here, because you are saying that I don't have the time to run my company, but he's not here, so no problem with that. So, today, the topic and the idea for the discussion, that's the Arctic, and I will touch upon the ideas, how Finland contributes in shaping sustainable Arctic economies. I will go through two main messages, where the first one is how we work in Finland. We dare to say that we are the world champions in ice breaking, but we still remember that we're a small country. So we have to stick together, and for that we have created Team Arctic Finland. So I will introduce you the concepts of Team Arctic Finland. Secondly, I will touch upon the Arctic Economic Council's development. So as we have heard already today, this body has just been established under the Canadian chairmanship period of the Arctic Council. To start with the Team Arctic Finland and our approach, as we are aware, any business, Arctic or any other business, needs many kinds of products, services, and know-how. We in Finland do have lots of very small enterprises or medium-sized enterprises. For them, it might be difficult to enter into discussions with big players, for instance, within the oil and gas industry or mining industry. However, these industries require and need big packages of services. Simultaneously, we are aware of the huge needs of the Arctic areas. And for these needs, we have created five types of product lines, where the first one on the left is the maritime infrastructure and ports, where we make optimized and total solutions for a whole life cycle focus. Secondly, we do industrial pre-feasibility and mining planning with service areas, for instance, like land and water management. Thirdly, we have an important area, which is the offshore production platforms, technologies, and services. Fourthly, shore-to-ship systems and solutions, creating ports, being reliable, safe, and eco-efficient. And last but not least, the hydro, tidal, and industrial energy solutions and services. So we have looked into the needs of the Arctic area We see that these would be the product lines which are needed in the future in the Arctic. We consist of 14 different companies. Many of them are present here today. And each of these companies is serving one of these product lines, a minimum. And we can select the needed companies in each of the product lines based on the customer's needs. So this is the way we work together with our customers, and especially potential customers, for the best of the Arctic in the future. So this is Team Arctic Finland, 5 product lines together with 14 Finnish companies, having a total amount of revenues today of 15 billion euros. One example of this is the icebreaker customer chain. We start from design, go into building and the owning and operating of the vessel. There we do have solutions for each of these needs, so the customer needs only one single point of contact. Here we have a case study of shaping the sustainable Arctic economies, where we have installed special urea injection oxycat system to our icebreaker fleet, which reduced the emissions of the sulfur by 99%, by the carbon and small particulates emissions by 50%, and the nitrogen emissions by 90%. Simultaneously, in one of our vessels we have installed, together with Lamor, the Finnish oil spill response company, an oil spill response system. So this is the way how we work together. Going into Arctic Economic Council and what is the work for Arctic Economic Council. So that, as said, is an independent organization that facilitates Arctic business-to-business activities and responsible economic development through sharing of best practices, technological solutions, standards and other information. The inaugural meeting of the Arctic Economic Council was held in Iqaluit, Nunavut, on September the 2nd and 3rd this year. And by the way, the Baffin Island is approximately twice the size of Finland, so this again tells us about the huge sizes within the Arctic. The purpose of our work is to work closely in cooperation with the Arctic Council and provide advice. So the members represent all types of businesses which operate in the Arctic, starting from mining, going into shipping companies, to reindeer herding and Aboriginal Economic Development Corporations. This mix of interests ensures that our work is carried out in an inclusive and sustainable manner. Where we have our focus? We have chosen 5 areas of work for the next 2 years. Well, the first one is to establish strong market connections between the Arctic states and try to lower barriers of trade between the Arctic states and also entering into the Arctic. Secondly, an important area for is the public-private partnerships, where there are very few taxpayers in the Arctic areas, so we need ways of leveraging the cost. Thirdly, stable regulation. Fourthly, facilitating knowledge and data exchange between industry and academia. And within the sessions through the forthcoming days in here, this item will also be more thoroughly addressed. And fifth, the indigenous knowledge and small businesses. So for the market connections, the central idea behind this Arctic to Arctic business approach is that where particular know-how, products, services or best practices have been implemented, they could work in all other Arctic areas as well. The Arctic Economic Council will work to ensure that this information is collected, disseminated and acted upon in order to ease and enhance business-to-business connections in the Arctic. Anyone doing business in the Arctic understands the huge need for infrastructure investments and the costs associated with that. Given the vast distances, the development of aviation infrastructure, for instance, is of high importance. This includes also establishment of deep water ports, road systems, telecommunications, IT. We need PPP to enable stakeholders from government, industry and other organizations to come together to identify these needs. Today's Arctic business environment is governed by stringent regulatory regimes, whether for oil and gas extraction or for mining, for instance. And so should it be. The Arctic is a pristine environment where people have thrived for generations. The Arctic Economic Council will work to promote best regulatory practices and, to the extent possible, seek to align rules and regulations to ease the flow of business. To realize these goals, the Arctic Economic Council will work closely with scientists and academia in general to collect, share and correlate data in order to ensure that information is not duplicated and can be utilized in the most effective manner possible. Indigenous businesses, and actually it should be very small enterprises, VSEs. So we shall respect the heritage, bearing in mind that today's VSEs or SMEs are tomorrow's big enterprises. We need stewardship for the good, for the development, for the northern societies. We will start our real work by creating working groups, and this process is ongoing, and the Arctic Economic Council has now requested their country representatives to give input for the contents of the work and the possible delegates for the working groups of the Arctic Economic Council. The business areas we have chosen are the infrastructure, energy, including oil, gas and renewables, mining, tourism, fishing, and human resources, investments and capacity building. They will work in the matrix within these five chosen areas of our visions and goals. So who we are then? We consist of 42 business representatives, which are appointed by 8 Arctic states and 6 indigenous organizations. The Arctic Economic Council is currently chaired by Mr. Tom Patton from Canada, and the vice chairs are Tara Sweeney from the United States, and she represents the Inuit Circumpolar Council, Yevgeny Ambrosov from Russia, and myself. Further information is already available in the internet in the Conference Board Canada website, and we seek to establish our own websites at the first convenience while the secretariat has been established. So to conclude my intervention here, what we are aiming for both in Finland for shaping the sustainable economies for the Arctic and within the Arctic Economic Council's work is improved northern societies with improved economies, giving better well-being, simultaneously understanding and respecting the complexity of the Arctic issues and trying to seek solution for that. And we shall admit that economy is a part of the society, so let's enhance the interaction. And we will give a holistic business perspective with our Team Arctic approach from Finland. Thank you very much, and I wish you great days here in the Iceland. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tero. I'm sure that you had the attention by all here, and we count on your continued support to the Arctic Economic Council and, of course, the Finnish expertise in that context also in the future. And now we turn to Mr. Petteri Taalas, the Director General of Finnish Meteorological Institute. We anticipated that it will rain in Reykjavik today, but when we took it as a fact only after Petteri told us so yesterday while we were flying to Reykjavik from Helsinki. The Finnish Meteorological Institute has always been a reliable source of information in Finland, but with Petteri's leadership, it has truly gained its global reputation. Expertise does not come without solid scientific and research background. We will hear of this also in his presentation. Mr. Taalas, the floor is yours.
Dear President Grimsson, dear President Niinistö, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to be here in Iceland for my 10th time already. And when we left Helsinki yesterday, we had beautiful sunshine. I'm responsible for the weather in Finland, and we came here and it's stormy and rainy. I was this morning calling my Icelandic colleague Arni Snorrason to complain about this weather, but he was responding from Santiago, Chile, so he escaped. So it's his problem that we are having this kind of weather, but it will improve for the evening. First, I would like to show you a short movie and thereafter some slides about Arctic science and Arctic services. Could we have the movie on?
Forecasting the weather allows us to help people and society prepare for the day ahead. And on about 50 days per year, forecasting is a life-saving endeavour. These are days when severe weather threatens people, property, and public safety. In cooperation with our clients, other authorities, and businesses, we develop situational awareness services for both everyday and severe weather. We also provide Finnish authorities and enterprises with 24/7 warnings about natural disasters around the globe. In order to better understand our own planet, FMI studies the conditions on other planets as well. Satellite data is an important factor in forecasting and research. It also provides crucial information on natural and man-made disasters, like floods, hazardous ice conditions, and the dispersion of harmful substances. FMI's extensive observation system is comprised of 8 radars and 450 observation stations. Today, FMI also manages all of Finland's aviation weather stations. Thanks to changes in data policy, FMI's weather observations and model data will be freely available and can be used, for example, to develop new service innovations. FMI's observations also provide valuable information on air pollution and greenhouse gas concentrations. The World Meteorological Community regularly reports records of multiple weather extremes. As the climate is changing, there is a strong need to produce forecasts that extend farther into the future. FMI and its international partners are working hard to develop forecasting models that will meet this challenge. FMI is in a unique geographical position to study various themes of global change in the northern context and to provide vital services to those operating in the region. Energy policy is also changing significantly, and FMI offers emissions-related consulting and research designed to help its clients make important energy-related decisions. FMI is also one of the world's most active meteorological institutes when it comes to helping developing countries to improve their own national warning systems. As we all share the same atmosphere, the benefits of this worthy work are literally felt across the globe. Here at the Finnish Meteorological Institute, we will never stop studying, analysing, and being amazed by our atmosphere, seas, and the phenomena that affect each and every one of us. Every day.
Okay, now you believe that we are doing good work in Finland in this field. Okay, and now I will tell you briefly what we know from a science perspective. We are just about to release the most recent summary for policymakers from IPCC in the governmental panel on climate change, and that report will be published the coming Sunday, and I will show some of the material from that report. Here is a graph showing what we have, how the temperature variation has been over the past 2,000 years. And of course, we don't have measurements from the Arctic for that period. And these longer estimates are based on tree rings, sediments, and so forth. But for the past 150 years, we have also measurements. And the overall trend has been cooling climate, but during the past 100 years, we have seen quite dramatic warming. And if we look more carefully, this warming has mostly been taking place during the winter half of the year. We have already seen these ice graphs in the previous presentations, and what was discussed in the previous panel was that we also have variability in the amount of Arctic ice. And during the past 2 years, we have had a little bit more ice than in 2012, which was a record low amount of Arctic ice. And this kind of variability will continue also in the future. So be prepared that sometimes we will have more harsh winters with ice and sometimes milder ones. And in the lower part of the panel, you can see that this development during the past decades has been unique in this 100 years period. And we haven't seen similar development going on in the Antarctic area.
And this is perhaps the most dramatic change that we have experienced. It's amount of multi-year ice which doesn't melt in summertime, and we have about one third of the multi-year ice left. And if you look at the mass, the change is even larger. There are also other indicators of Arctic global change, and this is discharge in the Arctic rivers, and the red curve indicates the eastern part of the Arctic, and the blue curve indicates the western part of the Arctic. So we can see that we are having more discharge in the rivers and positive trends, so more water, more melting water in the rivers. This is partly related to the rainfall amount changes and partly because of the melting of the Arctic snow and ice. We have also seen a change in the atmospheric composition, and here we have some measurements from northern part of Finland. We have measured CO2 concentrations for the past 15 years, and we have been exceeding so-called 400 ppm level, which is regarded as some sort of critical level. And we have also seen an increase in the methane concentration, and part of that is coming from the tropical zone, and part is coming from the Arctic areas. And we are cooperating with Russia, USA, and USA in Tiksi in eastern Siberia to monitor also these greenhouse gases, and this is how the methane concentration in the various Arctic stations look like. And this red curve indicates the measurements in Tiksi in eastern Siberia, where the permafrost is melting, and we have also plenty of organic matter in the waters and also in the land areas. And actually the highest concentrations in Tiksi are observed when the air masses are coming from the sea areas, and this is a new finding. And the second highest concentrations we observe in Pallas in Finland, where we also have wetlands. How the future is going to look like, this is from the most recent IPCC report. There are more than 30 institutes in the world who are making these calculations, and this is a summary of those calculations. And on the right-hand side, we can see so-called business as usual scenario, where we are not able to reduce the emissions, and on the left-hand side, you can see a case where the emissions have been heavily reduced. And on the right-hand side, you can see that the Arctic is going to be the area where the numbers are the highest, and there will be around 10 degrees by the end of this century, and in winter time, even more. What happened? Okay, so the presentation disappeared from here. Okay, so wake up. And the other important parameter is precipitation, which is shown in the lower panel of this graph, and you can see that we have the largest amount of blue color in the Arctic, which means the increased amount of rainfall, which means also snow in wintertime and water in summertime. And here we have the temperature scenarios for the whole world. And this red curve indicates this business as usual scenario, and the blue one indicates so-called 2-degree world. And in the middle of this panel, there's an estimate what's going to happen to the ice cover in September in the Arctic. And in this red curve, which is the business as usual scenario, we have estimated that by 2050, 2060, the whole Arctic might be ice-free, at least in September. And in this 2-degree scenario, there will be much less ice, but still some ice. And my friend Lauren Smith, who is also here today, he has published a paper about Arctic shipping routes, and on the left-hand side, you can see what is the situation today. So you can use a wide range of routes if you have ice-strengthened vessels, whereas 50 years from now, we can estimate that there are much more shipping routes available, even for vessels which are not strengthened for ice conditions. But as I said, there will be also in the future year-to-year variability. So this is not going to be a paradise like in tropics. So we will have there's a need for ice breaking assistance also in the future, which is good news for Tero Vauraste. And as was shown in the movie, we are producing plenty, wide range of services to various customers, and we produce about 1 million products for various customers, and some of them are related to the marine transportation. And we have a fairly nice setup for the Baltic Sea, which is frozen every winter. And because of this frozen Baltic Sea, we have started providing ice services already for the past 100 years. And there we need satellite data, we need models, and we need experts and scientific know-how to produce these products. And we have also started issuing seasonal forecasts, so what's going to happen during the coming month and what's going to happen during the coming three months. And also those products have been fairly satisfactory. And this know-how that we have gathered from the Baltic Sea, we have all started using also for the Arctic, and we are providing operationally services for the Arctic area, and we have also invested as Finland resources to this field. Both our Technology and Innovation Funding Agency, TEKES, and our Academy has started fairly extensive programs for the Arctic. And satellites are nowadays key players in this field, and we are using plenty of satellite sources. For example, we are receiving Italian Egeos radar satellite in Finland and producing products for various customers based on that data. And we have various products for the Arctic, and we also have statistics to estimate what's going to happen in the coming decades. And it's also important to deliver these products to the users, and there are various sources to deliver the products to the customers, and sometimes these customers are in the middle of the Arctic Sea areas, and it's more challenging to get nice large products delivered there. So finally, some remarks. So we expect to see opening of these sea routes. First is northeastern passage, thereafter southeastern passage, and finally across the North Pole, as I was showing. But these ice conditions will vary from year to year, and when we have more open water, there's a risk for more packed ice cases. And when it comes to economic activities, one of the drivers is this climate change that I was showing to you, but also the price of oil and gas, they are drivers there, and at the moment we are also rethinking the global energy policy. And in the future, there's need for scenarios from our type of community to produce what's going to happen and when, and how the conditions will be in the future. And as our president said, Santa Claus is living in Finland, and I have always told Santa Claus to provide more satellite data for provision of better services, and he has promised to do so. And there we need international cooperation. And what is changing in the Arctic has an impact on the weather also worldwide, so it's not only Arctic issue. So with these words, I would like to thank you, and have a nice evening here.
Thank you very much, Mr. Dallas, for this very, very interesting presentation. Just one question. What is the weather in Reykjavik tomorrow? Will it clear up?
I have to call my colleague from Santiago, but it seems that it will be better. It won't be so stormy anymore, but it will be a little bit grayish. But in Finland, it will be perfect tomorrow. So please come there.
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, we have now been traveling to the sea and to the space in previous presentations. So now is the time to go to the ground, and as a matter of fact, underground. The Arctic is not only water and ice. It is also a territory with forestry and rich mineral resources. Here, clean tech and green mining are the name of the game. Mr. Pertti Korhonen, the CEO and president of the Autotech company, knows all about this, so we are pleased to invite him to share his views with us now. Mr. Korhonen.
Thank you, President Grimson, President Niinistö, ladies and gentlemen. It's my great pleasure to address you with this outlook to sustainable Arctic mining. I grew up in northern part of Lapland, roughly 100 kilometers up from the Arctic Circle, I know snow and Arctic circumstances very well. I'm representing company Outotec, who is delivering technology solutions all over the world to mining and metals industries. We have roots that go back to 19th century, more than 100 years. We are providing solutions to Kalahari Desert, to the sand deserts of Saudi Arabia, to 4 kilometers in Andes in Chile, and to many customers in Arctic region. Arctic industry is a great opportunity. Arctic region is very rich in natural resources, and of course this is a great opportunity to utilize those resources. And when the infrastructure in the area is developing, of course this becomes more and more possible. Let's look how this actually looks in practice, and let's look at some of the statistics. So if we look at the map here on the right-hand side, we can see that there's a lot of activity already today around the Arctic area in utilization of minerals resources. So in practice, all the states are somehow involved in these activities already today. And it may be a surprise to you that today 36% of world's diamonds or 25% of world's nickel actually comes from Arctic area. So it's happening today. There are 88 mines which are run in Arctic, and actually there are more than 800 mining projects that are under development in various stages. And the value of these projects today is estimated to be roughly $150 billion. So this is already a huge industry, which has a lot of significance to the economy of the Arctic, but the prospects of the future are even more mind-blowing. However, what is extremely important is that in this fragile environment, we will use these resources in a sustainable manner. When we use these resources in a sustainable manner, they will bring social wealth to the area. It will provide long-term jobs, safe jobs for people. It will provide opportunities to educate people and engage and really include them into sharing this wealth that can be created from these resources. We heard this morning from the Secretary General of OECD that we need growth, but we need growth which is green, and we need growth which is inclusive. And I believe that metals will always be part of a sustainable society. We need metals in the modern society. However, they need to be produced in a sustainable way. So environmental aspects are, of course, extremely critical in this fragile environment in Arctic. And of course, it goes without saying that when these resources are used in a sustainable manner, it creates a lot of economical wealth for local people, for enterprises, and of course, for the countries. So what do we need to utilize these resources in a sustainable manner? We need technologies that can decouple the economical well-being and the creation of the welfare from its impact to the environment. We need sustainable technologies. We need eco-efficiency. And the good news is that this kind of technology exists already today. So it is only about responsible decision-making when planning how these resources are used. The technology is there, it's there to be used. It's not a surprise that it is the Nordic countries that are providing most of the mining and metals processing technology to the world today. We have learned to utilize natural resources already for decades in a responsible manner, respecting the environmental limitations and conditions. And especially, of course, in Finland, we have a lot of knowledge how to operate in harsh Arctic conditions. And my message is that with modern and clean technologies, metals can be produced in a sustainable manner. The picture that you see here is from Kevitsa mine in Finland. It's the company First Quantum who operates a mine there. This is roughly 100 kilometers up from Arctic Circle and producing copper and nickel and running on Outotec's sustainable technology. Mining is not only about machines, but it is very, very much about people. To operate these kind of plants, one really needs top-level professionals. So this provides job opportunities and educational opportunities for the local people, including the indigenous people. I believe that responsible mining is very much about inclusiveness and taking the local people with to the development of how these resources can be used. And of course, this means that we need education locally, and it's not only metallurgists who are needed, but one needs accountants, one needs business people, one needs human resources people, one needs operators, one needs ICT people, because digitalization is more and more and more part of modern mining. So this is actually a pretty sophisticated industry that requires a lot of knowledge to operate, and of course that means great opportunity for people. We also need to have research, so it's important that the Arctic countries are investing in research of technology so that we can all the time bring more and more sustainable solutions for utilizing these resources. One example that I would like to show here is in Sweden. It's LKAB's iron mining plant, and this plant here is of an iron ore pelletizing plant that Outotec has built for them, and this is the cleanest iron ore pelletizing plant in the world with extremely minimum emissions to the nature and also very high degree of energy efficiency. So technologies exist. What is now extremely important is that we are committed to a vision where we will use these resources in a responsible manner. So we are not just exploiting them economically, but we are using it in such a manner that we are in balance with the environment, and in an inclusive manner we are also including local people to provide them opportunities. So I would call this a great sustainable development opportunity in all three dimensions of sustainability. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Korhonen. I think your message, we heard it loud and clear, very, very important. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we have a few minutes for your comments or questions to our experts, and of course, President Niinistö, if there are any from the audience, now is the time. I think yes, I see it there. Please, madam.
Hello, Mr. President, members of panel. My name is Anni Mäkelä. I'm originally from Oulu in Finland, but I'm here to represent the University of Aberdeen in Scotland. And I'm a marine scientist, so my question is about the scientific strategy of Finland for the Arctic. And this is especially for Professor Talas. You mentioned some research initiatives that are coming up and the shift from going from Baltic research to the main of the Arctic. So can you please tell me more about these research programs that might in the future give me a job, hopefully?
Okay, so for the latter, we have to have some offline discussions perhaps. Perhaps I don't promise anything here. But anyhow, this Arctic as a research topic and also as a business topic has been focal in Finland during the past years, and as our president said, and our main science and innovation funding agencies, Finnish Academy, and also TEKES, which is our technology and innovation funding agency, they have both started fairly extensive Arctic programs, and this TEKES program is of the order of 100 million euros, and there will be also funding from the private sector, practical projects, and Finnish Academy has already been running Arctic research program for the past 2 years, interesting topics are, for example, what's going to happen to the snow and ice cover, and what kind of opportunities there are, how to operate in the Arctic in a safe manner, and this experience that we have gathered from the Baltic Sea safety area, that's highly useful also for the Arctic conditions. It's very important that when we operate there, we do it in the safest possible manner.
If I may just add on to that, we have in the Lapland University the initiation to create the EU Arctic Center and EU Arctic Research Center over there as well. So that is one initiative as well in this area.
Thank you very much for your comments. And there, Madam, I think next, you're next.
Thank you. The lady in pink again. I would like to ask you a practical question. I have full confidence in your clean tech solutions when it comes to new metals and mining, but I would like to know how high a percentage is recycled minerals in the Finnish industrial field. Thank you.
Thank you for the question. One of the reasons why I said that metals are part of sustainable society is that metals actually are almost indefinitely recyclable to infinity. So it's a great resource that can be recycled. I do not remember exact numbers of recycling percentages in Finland, but I believe that they are actually extremely high. I would claim that probably copper would be close to very high numbers. But of course, in the whole world, we do have still a lot of opportunities to improve the recycling of metals. And especially the, let's say, industrial metals, precision metals, the rare earth metals, which are, for example, used in mobile phones, we could improve a lot still the recycling of those metals. They are often done in mom and pop shops in poor countries, not operated necessarily in an environmentally sustainable way. So the good news is that technologies exist, but we need to get a better grip on the recycling of the metals, and this is a global need, but technologies do exist.
Thank you very much. Now I don't see any more comments or questions, so
Hannu, let me.
Okay, Tero.
Hannu here has been so kind and told who we are, but nobody has told who you are. So Mr. Hannu Halinen here is the Arctic ambassador of our country, Finland, and I just wanted to take this small intervention in the conclusion part of this panel, since Hannu has regrettably told that he's going to retire. However, having said that, he will still be active in the service with additional activities in the future as well. But Hannu, I want to personally thank you for your great collaboration for the Arctic, for a great collaboration of the Finnish Foreign Service and the Finnish Arctic Business Cluster. It's been great to work with you, and personally I'm sad to see you go on pension, but I'm glad to hear that you will continue in the project. So why don't we all give Hannu a great applause?
Thank you. Yes, all good things come to an end at some point. Well, we have come to the end of this session, and I hope you all can now, after these presentations, agree with me that Finland knows how to reconcile business opportunities in the Arctic with environmental requirements and sustainability through international cooperation. As President Niinistö stressed in the morning in his statements, regarding the three elements, research, clean tech and know-how, Finland is in top shape. So with this, I want to thank President Niinistö, our experts and the audience. And of course, on a personal note, thank you and goodbye.